welcome you all to this session of ISO. Today we are going to discuss about what has changed between ISO 9001:2008 and ISO 9001:2015. Well, in the previous version, that is 2008 version, there were total 8 clauses. The first 3 clauses are still common, but in 2015 version of ISO 9001, now we have 10 clauses total. So earlier we had 8 clauses, now there are 10 clauses, but the first 3 clauses are identical. The very first clause is introduction, starting with introduction. Then clause number 1 is scope. Clause number 2 is normative references. Clause number 3 is terms and definitions. And then clause number 4 onwards, it is changing. In the earlier version, there were 5 clauses, starting with clause number 4. Clause number 4 was quality management system. Number 5 was management responsibility. Number 6 was resource management. Number 7 was product realization. And number 8 was measurement, analysis and improvement. Now in clause number 2015, the nomenclature has changed. Clause number 4 is now context of the organization. Now this particular clause details out the requirement for some kind of analysis by the top management regarding the organization before you start making your system. So this clause is now very important, and with having direct responsibility of the top management, you can't leave it to any middle level or junior level person. Clause number 5 is leadership. Clause number 6 is planning. Clause number 7 is support. Clause number 8 is operations. Then clause number 9 is performance evaluation. And number 10 is improvement. So these are the new nomenclatures. And now the key changes between the earlier version, that is 2008 version, and today's version, that is 2015 version, is that in the new version, there is more emphasis on risk-based management. We have to identify what are the risks and what are the opportunities, and then take care of these risks. It is more emphatic on preventive action. The new standard puts more emphasis on preventive action. Increased emphasis on achieving value for the organization and its customers. That is why we identify the requirements of the internal and external customers, both. Then the documented information. Earlier we used to have documents and records, and now the new term is documentation. Decreased emphasis on documentation in this particular standard. Now expands the concept of documentation and replaces documents and records. Organizational context is something new in this. Responsiveness to the business environment. There is more emphasis on this. Outsourcing is now external provision. Enhanced leadership requirement in this new standard, as I told you. No requirement for management representative. Earlier it was an essential requirement that top management was supposed to appoint an MR, management representative, who will be responsible for coordination with various agencies and the development of the system. So now there is no requirement of management representative. Anybody on behalf of the top management or the top management themselves can take care of the system. And no requirement of quality manual as such. In the documentation earlier, quality manual was getting a lot of importance. Even today, the new standard doesn't say that you don't have a quality manual, but there is no requirement as such. In my opinion, it is worthwhile to have a document like quality manual where you can put various kinds of information which are again required in this new standard. So, it's in my opinion, quality manual is quite useful. Now, the new standard has got a structure which we call as high level structure, and the new clause numbers are there as I... Well, in the next session, we are going to discuss about the context of the organization which the top management is supposed to think about and ponder over various requirements of this particular clause number 4. The various sub clauses are understanding the context of the organization in which the external and internal issues have to be identified, and then understanding the needs and expectations of the interested parties. The organization has to determine the interested parties relevant to the QMS and the requirement of these interested parties. Interested parties could be direct customers, end users, suppliers, regulators, and any other entity. Now, next clause is 4.3, determining the scope of the quality management system. And we have discussed a little bit in more detail regarding this aspect in a previous video which you can refer to. And then clause number 4.4 is QMS and its processes. You have to determine the various processes, their interaction, and the come out with process control sheets, and where you show the sequence and interaction of processes, and also maintain the documented information regarding your quality management system. We will talk about this particular clause in more detail in our next video. So, goodbye till then. Thank you very much for watching this video.